All right. So, is time really an illusion? All right. So,
yes.
Yeah, I know. I totally agree. So, I want to start with kind of the maybe some background on how you got into film, why you got into film, what was it about film in particular that drew you to that medium. I remember, I sometimes tell my students, I ask them to come up with a film that they saw when they were 10. I don't know why 10 is an age, at least in my head, for them, that kind of changed the way they looked at films. And I have one. There was this little movie, tiny little film called Star Wars. And so that certainly had a big impact on my life.
My son saw that at 10 also with the same,
my goodness.
The same effect.
Right, I know, right?
I'm older than that.
So, yeah, well, your sons and myself are kind of screwed, I think, because we saw Star Wars probably 1,000 times when it came out, right?
And his daughter, who's now 4, she hasn't seen it yet, but she's playing with all the figures, and she's really in love with Star Wars.
I know. So, but was there a film, was there something when you were younger that...
My parents, for my 4th birthday, took me to the Michigan Theater in Detroit. Well, actually, what they took me out to was a restaurant at the Statler Hotel. And they said there was going to be a floor show that we could watch, or I could go to a movie. And I honestly didn't know the difference between a floor show or a movie, but the word movie attracted me. Mm-hmm. So I said, I want to go to a movie. And the maitre d' came over and said, you've really got to stay for the floor show. It's going to be amazing. I said, no, I want to go to a movie. So we went to see the Al Jolson story.
Okay.
And we saw the Al Jolson story, and I was like that. Uh-huh. And when it was over, my parents said, let's go. I said, no. And they were going to show it again. Mm-hmm. So I watched it twice.
Oh, wow.
And I think
cool.
At that point, I was hooked on movies.
Yeah.
And I would go every Saturday afternoon to matinees in Detroit. And, I loved movies. I didn't know that I would make them exactly. My grandmother's first cousin married Al Warner. So I was in some vague way related to the Warner Brothers.
Okay.
So whenever they would have a cartoon, Bugs Bunny, and that's all folks, and the Warner Brother thing would come on the screen, I would go, that's my cousins!
Yeah, right.
I thought I had an entry point to Hollywood.
Yeah.
It didn't prove to be worth anything, but it was really, really fascinating to me.
Mm-hmm.
I loved movies, and then interestingly, like David and Janet, we're pretty close to the same age, and so we had a lot of the same influences. And mm-hmm. I didn't want to make Rock Hudson and Doris Day movies. That just never seemed to me to be what I wanted to do, and I was really interested in theater.
Mm-hmm.
And then they talked about Wild Strawberries. That was the movie that first made me go, oh, my God, it's not just Rock Hudson and Doris mm-hmm. Day. And, in those days, you couldn't just go to a movie and see Citizen Kane or something like that. The history of film hadn't yet been available.
Mm-hmm.
So I just... I said, there's something else going on here. And then there was Truffaut and Antonioni and all the extraordinary European filmmakers of that moment. And I just said, this is the new art form.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all I wanted to do. And I went to NYU at that point in time to study filmmaking. And my classmates were, Martin Scorsese was one, and Brian De Palma was mm-hmm. one. And there was a whole group of us. And
it was a Master of Science back then,
it
right?
was.
Or a Bachelor of
a Bachelor
Science.
A Bachelor of Science, yeah.
Right,
and it was not even the Tisch School yet.
Yeah.
It was Haig Manoogian was the head of the program. And we just all loved movies. Marty more than anybody. I mean, he knew every cinematographer and every DP. And I mean every editor. He knew everybody.
Mm-hmm.
And I had no idea that these guys were so important. And he knew Hollywood movies. Like, I didn't know that was important. But mm-hmm. we were just all starting to get into the European cinema, and it was taking over our lives. We were thrilled beyond belief to be able to make films in that genre that had sort of novelistic quality to them,
deep
characters, dark stories that were important to tell.
Yeah, there's something about movies that it's so close to dreaming, a movie experience. You go into this darkened theater, at least in my romantic view, that's what you do, and you experience this world and these images, and you come out and you wake up and you're back in the real world. And there's something about, for me, going to a film during the day. I love going, disappearing into a darkened theater to watch a film and coming out, where it's still light out.
Also to experience the collective.
Mm-hmm. Right, with an audience.
Yeah, audiences they're really important.
Yeah, that's a great, great point. Can you elaborate on that? And what's your experience with that? I assume you've seen your films with different audiences. And
sure, no, but even just watching movies on TV and going to a theater is so vastly different. To laugh with a group of people instead of just by yourself somehow expands your sense of self so that you don't feel quite so alone in the universe. You feel connected in some much larger way.
Right.
And it really is a collaboration. It's all of us in the theater with the movie, which is the movie's coming off the screen. We're meeting it somewhere in the middle, and there's this extraordinary journey happening in our psyches that we love.
Yeah.
I mean, you can do it in a novel, because something's coming off the page and suddenly you're in that universe. And you can do it, you can kind of do it on television, but the distractions are so enormous that they don't quite allow for quite that depth of experience.
And you can pause it.
And you can pause it. You have a lot of control, But in a movie, you watch that first scene and you kind of go, I'm game. Right. I'm willing to go with this. You know, same as reading a screenplay. Mm-hmm. Page one, you know if you're going to go on that ride.
Right.
Page two, you're either signed out or you're really on board.
Right.
And you've got to get people, and it's not with hooks and drama. It's with a sense of place and presence. Something about the way a person writes, you know, you've been engaged. You've been drawn into that special world, and we want that because it takes us out of ourselves.
Right.
And that's what we all want. We're all so imprisoned in our own being that the idea of being outside of that spectrum is so beautiful and wonderful, and that's what we look for.
I have a little ongoing battle with some of the administration about you know, everything's going online these days, you know, classes online and everything online, and I teach this class called Film Philosophy, where we watch these movies and we talk philosophical concepts and blah blah blah, and I insist on having it in this theater. It has to be in this theater, and I'm reluctant to have it online because then the students will not experience the movie in the theater. And I will talk. I bring up to these folks, robots I call them, or replicants. Actually, David Webb Peoples would like that one. These replicants about how. That experience when I was 10 in seeing Star Wars, there were no seats in the theater. There were no seats. So I had to sit in front of the front row with a bunch of other probably 10-year-olds. And it was so packed. It just waiting in line took, you know, an hour and a half because it snakes around the block. And seeing a film, like, it's so gone now. I mean, that experience is just not there, where you go experience this movie with a ton of other people that, and you can feel it. It's such a different experience.
I think it may still be there for some 10-year-olds. Honestly, I think at 10 years old, you are so ripe for that experience. And but that's, Star Wars was unique in that it didn't just speak to 10-year-olds. I was in my 30s. Mm-hmm. I watched that film and I went, finally. You know, I had watched, you know, Flash Gordon as a kid, where you could see the string holding the rocket ship flying to the moon. Sure. You know, and I used to go, one day they'll get there. One day we'll see something real. Well, the first moment with that ship coming by and the extraordinary music by
John Williams.
John Williams. And I just went, thank you. I just went, thank you. And it was a thank you that went all the way through to the end. And I particularly loved that it had it dealt with the Force. And the idea that it took this concept that was so profound to me and so rarely expressed in film, and there it was at the core of a movie, this idea of something that you had to turn off everything else in order to know it and to feel it. And when you did, you saved humanity or the world or whatever that was at that point. And I thought, wow, they really got it. I personally don't think he ever understood George. I don't think George got it later. I think every other film turned the Force into magic.
Sure.
But in the first film, it's not magic. This is the Force.
Yeah.
And that went into people's minds. And I think that's why that series is so powerful.
Yeah, it's really interesting to watch that film with students today. Like, I insist, I'm a Star Wars snob, so I insist on showing, it's hard to find, but the version of the film that is not even called A New Hope or Episode 4, it's just called Star Wars.
Right.
And it's without any of the new digital effects. It's with the, you know, the robots and the puppets and stuff like that. And even today, the students, the audience will cheer when Luke Skywalker turns off his computer, because he's then following his instinct, being a human, like fully being a human being and allowing himself to be, you know, to to give himself over to this. And it's this beautiful, profound thing, and people cheer, and I don't think they even really understand why they're cheering.
I think they do.
Like internally, yeah.
I think we all know how lost we are in the world of materialized stuff. Okay. You know, I think we all get a sense of we don't know what to do about it because it's so seductive and attractive and surprising every day, and we so want to be caught in the world, but we all know we're lost. Mm-hmm. And that lostness is a real problem. And how do you find your way back when you don't even know, except in some psychological sense, that things aren't quite right? And that, I think, is really important to address.
So have you always kind of, thought about these kind of things? I mean, I know I read somewhere where you took a year and traveled, and that had a big impact on kind of your worldview and what you wanted to do. And
it was very essential. But let me talk first. Before I took a year and a half to hitchhike around the world, I took about 3 billion years on a trip with LSD.
Okay.
This was back in the 60s. God knows how that plays to you guys today. I don't know.
Well, fill us in. This is just water, by the way. I think.
Well, I only tell you because I think it was so important in terms of changing everything about my sense of self and worldview. It was initiatory in a way that our culture doesn't provide at all. There's no initiation in Western culture to anything. In the olden days, we had the Dionysian rituals. There were so many different ways of finding a way into something much deeper than the world presents us. Okay. But LSD in the 60s was not yet a class whatever drug. Mm-hmm. And Tim Leary was doing it. And my roommate was a very good friend of Tim Leary's. And a guy from England named Michael Hollingshead was bringing over some pure LSD from Sandoz Laboratory and about to take it up to Millbrook, which is where Tim Leary was doing private experimentations with it.
Awesome.
And they asked if the day that I was going to take my first LSD trip, and I had a little pill about this big that was 650 micrograms, which was massive, sitting in my wallet waiting for the right moment. I had determined this would be the day.
What made this day?
I don't know. It was the middle of July, and I was ready. I was right.
It was the day.
And that very day, Michael Hollingshead arrives at my basement apartment in New York on Bank Street, and he says, I've got this vial of pure LSD from Sandoz Laboratory. I'm taking it up to Tim tomorrow. Can we please leave this in your refrigerator overnight? And so you all know where this is going. So we did, and then that evening I took my little tablet out of my wallet and took it, and nothing happened, literally nothing, for about an hour. So my friend Barry said, well, you know, we have this jar in the refrigerator. And he said, let me get a little eyedropper. And he goes and he fills the entire eyedropper. And he goes to give me one drop, which is what you're supposed to do. And he goes, oops. And the whole eyedropper, which is thousands of micrograms, goes shooting down my throat.
And then comes Jacob's Ladder.
That's exactly right.
Right.
I mean, we can cut to that if you wish.
Right.
It was definitely a life-changing experience in ways that, again, nothing tends to give people. Mm-hmm. And it did last you and I started talking earlier about timelessness. Mm-hmm. Time stopped pretty quickly. Mm-hmm. There was no such thing as time. There was no such thing as me. There was no such thing as this world. There was only this involuted sense of infinite, eternal being, mm-hmm. very powerful. Mm-hmm. And I had no idea what to make of it mm-hmm. at all. So when I came back from this trip, my friend Barry came back a very different person. Mm-hmm. I'll tell you what happened when I came back. It was really intriguing. I thought I was dead, actually, and probably was dead. I don't know. Thus, ghost. But I thought I was dead, and then suddenly, in the immensity of stillness that I experienced, I felt like I had been inseminated. Like something went plop, and the next thing I knew, I just started. Like I divided into two and four and eight and went on and on and on. Mm-hmm. And the whole chunks of my previous being returned. And there I was back in the room mm-hmm. where I had started this whole journey. And I remember saying, why am I back? Mm-hmm. And this voice said to me from somewhere, don't ask where or how, to tell people what you saw. Mm-hmm. And I had a feeling that was the beginning of why I'm sitting here. Mm-hmm. And then I tried to figure out I got to understand what this was, because there's nothing in our culture that talks about it very much. Sure. At least I didn't know about it at that point. So Barry gave me a book called the Bhagavad Gita, which is the Hindu song of God. And I looked at that book and I started saying, wow, if I had read this two nights ago, I wouldn't have understood a word. And now it was like concrete reality. Mm-hmm. I had the Timothy Leary's guide for these experiences was the Tibetan Book of the Dead. So I got very compelled by Tibetan teaching. And the next thing I knew, I wanted to tell everybody that LSD was a sacramental drug, and then somebody killed their mother-in-law and said they blamed it on LSD, and it became illegal. Mm-hmm. So what happened for me was I wanted to find out what this Hindu teaching was. I wanted to find out what the Buddhists knew that I didn't know. Mm-hmm. And then I started reading a book called Perennial Philosophy by Aldous Huxley, which started to talk about mystical experience in every religion, not just Buddhist Hindu, so that there's the Kabbalah in Judaism, and the Christian religion has enormous mystical teachings. And I even refer to one of them in Jacob's Ladder of Meister Eckhart, who is a great 16th century theologian, mystic. Mm-hmm. And St. Teresa of Avila, there's a lot of them. And I started reading all of these, and I said, oh my God, there's a whole culture of understanding in the universe that that I never knew about, and that nobody taught me about in elementary school or high school or college. So I set off on a round-the-world trip that lasted a year and a half, going from one culture to another to another. And at that point, you could go overland. So I was able to go from Greece to Turkey to Iran, Afghanistan, Pakistan. I mean, I got to really move through the places in the world that are now so dangerous. And I was able to watch how culture moved and became part of one whole, rather than these discrete kinds of this country, this country, this country. People were part of one unit. Mm-hmm. And I found it to be amazing, but I did not find the teacher I was looking for. Mm-hmm. And I met a lot of teachers, and I had an extraordinary experience, and it was wonderful. I came back to America, and I did meet a teacher who became very significant in my life, and I started practicing meditation. And the thing I learned about meditation was that it was about sitting still. Mm-hmm. And you can practice any number of forms of meditation. They kind of, none of them matter. They just try to give you somewhere to put your mind so that when you're sitting still, you're not totally bored. Mm-hmm. And you start to sit still, and then you go to a place that is beyond boredom. And it's hard to describe what that is. And the only reason I'm bringing it up for all of you guys is because it's the source of creation. Mm-hmm. And out of it comes the essence of who you are and what you are. And it comes in the same way that an idea pops into your head out of nothing.
Right.
Suddenly there you are with this, what's that?
Right.
And if you get really quiet, there's a powerhouse of insight, knowledge, wisdom, questioning, exploration, that if you want to turn it into movies, you can turn it into movies, you can turn it into novels, into poetry, into television shows, whatever you want. But it's so rich and so deep and so extraordinarily powerful that it will give you enough to work with for the rest of your life and probably beyond.
Right.
And it's really, really remarkable. And so if you look at my films, they're all attempts, and not always effective ones, but they're all attempts to play with some of the things I learned during that journey, both the LSD journey and the travels, and then the journey of life, of getting married and having a wonderful wife and having two incredible children and now grandchildren. The journey is so rich and so varied, and you start to get stuff, and then just like David and Janet were saying, my career didn't start till I was 40 either, and a little bit further on. And the reason it didn't start is because it takes a long time to find your voice, to know who you are, to find a way to take what you know or what you're learning and put it into dramatic form. Mm-hmm. But I'm very driven by thematic ideas, and you and I were, that's what the reason you wanted this conversation today was to talk theme. Mm-hmm. That's where all my themes come from, that place.
Right. Well, that's great. I mentioned to you last night about taking this trip to meet with David Lynch in Fairfield, where he was part of this transcendental meditation conference thing.
Right. Right.
And after that, it was a real profound, it was just a great experience. And but after that experience, I was, and it was actually Donovan was there, and Donovan was playing music and singing da da da, and I was picking up on the way Donovan was singing, and the way he enunciates, you know, his phrases and his lyrics, and I was catching this pattern kind of repeating, and it was almost, it was very trance-like. And then I went back and started looking at David Lynch's work, and I was noticing a very similar way of not only editing the films, but the way the dialogue is spoken, and there are, it's not always successful. Sometimes it doesn't work, but there
But it does often work. And, and David comes from a very similar place.
Right.
And he's found a language for it, a unique, very exciting language. And he's found a way to get the experience, if not the ideas specifically, he gets the experience out there. So you watch a David Lynch film and your mind just can't hold it.
It doesn't
add up in a rational sense, but its irrational truth is so powerful.
Right, that's a great way to put it.
And you want it. You want to get there because our rational truth locks us up from real truth.
Mm-hmm.
Because we think this is all there is.
Right.
But it's not. There's a sudden otherness. And when you get at it from these different angles, you start to go, I don't really know anything.
Yeah, it's really beautiful. And I really noticed it when I was watching Twin Peaks, the series, and I could pick out the episodes that he did not direct. And even though it's the same characters, the same location, the same DP, all the same stuff, it's not told the same way he's telling the story, and it's different, and you can feel that. So, well, let's get to the work that you then started doing. So, Jacob's Ladder, I remember reading about the script before it was made. And hearing how it was on everybody's list of, I think it was the best unproduced screenplays in the industry. Right. So can you talk about where you were at that point in time when you wrote it? What inspired that? Because there's some things in there. You talk about LSD. I mean, that's directly in that film. And then the war in Vietnam and this theme that you go back to throughout all of your work. Even the disaster movie, I guess you'd call it, Deep Impact. I mean, it's still dealing with death and what happens after death, and on a bigger scale, what does it mean to be alive? So can you talk about that? Like, where were you when you started going, okay, I'm going to write this story about this guy named Jacob?
90 minutes west of here, in DeKalb, Illinois.
Okay.
My wife was a professor there. And I couldn't get work for the life of me anywhere. And so I started writing this movie. Mm-hmm. I didn't know what it was, but I knew it was about a guy. I thought it was a guy who was dead. And the Tibetan Book of the Dead kept percolating through my brain. And I started writing it, and then I had this revelation that was so powerful that I jumped out of the chair and I walked around the dining table about 150 times. I was so excited that I was making the feature-length version of an occurrence at Olive Creek Bridge,
right.
And that he wasn't dead, he was in the process of dying.
Right.
That this is that the death process is a kind of letting go of everything you have been and were and trying to make sense of your death, which I think is a real process for people.
Sure.
And so I got what I was doing, and I was writing, and I was typing, and my wife walked in one day and looked over my shoulder, and she was like, what are you writing? She thought it was terrible. I was just scared to death. And I said, I don't know, but I can't stop. And I just kept writing and writing this script, and it just found its own voice. And it came from a place that was not here.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't cognitively written. It came out of the gut. You often point to your gut when you start to talk about when you just kind of know something.
Mm-hmm.
That's where it came from, this kind of knowing something. And it just wanted to be presented. And there, it was facilitated by having a typewriter and having an openness to its arrival.
Mm-hmm.
So in the end, I kind of was taking dictation, and writing as fast as I could, and it just arrived and arrived and arrived and arrived, and I was knocked out by what was there. I could tell it was well written because, in a way, I hadn't written it. Because if I had written it, it wouldn't have been very good. But the fact that it was being written was like I knew I was in touch with something, and it was astounding to see it come on the page. In those days, it wasn't a computer; it was just paper, but I could see it coming out of the machine, and I was like, "My God, this is really, really powerful."
You were taking dictation.
I really was, and then when it was done, I had something that I could show people, and it helped me enormously in terms of getting stuff around. It didn't get me to Hollywood exactly. It did find me an agent ultimately. It was a kind of a a celebrated script in Hollywood. People right. had read it. When I went out to Hollywood finally, people knew who I was, and I was surprised by that because I didn't know how much people would read material mm-hmm. that was sort of out there that was being commented on.
Right.
So it was a very good door opener for me, and it's a very powerful script, but I didn't know how to write a script. You know, it was a little bit like what Josh was saying before. You know, there were no places to go to see how to write a script. So I just wrote a description and dialogue in the middle of the page. Description, dialogue in the middle of the page. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was a script. But it was interesting because it really read well. Because mm-hmm. it didn't read like interior, exterior, out there, where, you sure. know, day, night. It just read.
Right.
And so that opened all the doors for me. And more, I mean, I had had a film before that mm-hmm. that opened that I had. It's a very long story, but it's called Brainstorm, and it was mm-hmm. Natalie Wood's last film.
Right.
And it got made with me as the author, but not the screenwriter, because I had right. finally given up the rights to do the screenplay.
You have story by credit.
I have story by,
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. yeah.
But it was a very extraordinary experience. It really a great introduction to Hollywood. I mean, the truth is, I came out to see the film for 1 week of its shooting, the week just before Natalie died, mm-hmm. and I got on the set, and Chris Walken was changing every line of dialogue, mm-hmm. everything, and I'm going, because I didn't know what to say. I had no power mm-hmm. at all, and I couldn't tell him that everything changes without those lines being there. It was really painful, mm-hmm. but it's the experience that most writers have mm-hmm. in the business. You watch your stuff being altered and changed, and if they let you on the set, mm-hmm. And I, nothing I could do about it, really. And then Natalie died, and there was some real question of whether the film could be finished.
Sure.
And MGM kind of wanted to throw in the towel and just say, let's just junk it. And Doug Trumbull took the film, the negative, and locked himself in a vault. And he said, this film can be done, and you're not going to touch this negative until I finish it. And he mm-hmm. convinced Lloyd's of London that we were able to make this movie. Mm-hmm. And they provided the final monies for it rather than mm-hmm. pay the studio off for a loss.
Right.
They just paid whatever it took to finish the film. Right. And it came out. And we had these T-shirts that said, Brainstorm, a Lloyd's of London production. Because they really did save the movie.
Yeah.
And then that movie came out, and it was in the theaters maybe 3 weeks. Mm-hmm. It made no money. And I realized that it had done nothing for my career. Mm. That having a film in the theater playing with your name on it doesn't mean anything mm-hmm. unless it grabs hold of the zeitgeist of the moment, you know, sure. in some way.
But it did let you explore. I mean, I don't want to say the film's only about one thing, but there's again, like if I remember correctly, there's moments in the film where they're recording somebody dying.
That was the key idea.
Right.
He makes a machine that you can put on your head, very virtual reality. Mm-hmm. He puts this machine on his head, and it records all of your thoughts, minds, emotions,
right.
everything. And then you can put it on someone else's head, and they can experience everything.
Right.
And then his cohort in the laboratory has a heart attack. And mm-hmm. while she's having a heart attack, she takes the helmet and puts it on and records it.
Right. While she
and does. So you get to see, one, that death is not an end. Mm-hmm. So again, one of my themes.
Right.
And she has this enormous journey outside of her mind. Mm-hmm. It's some kind of, it's like traveling above the earth in some kind of bubble memory outside of everything that we know to be logical and true.
Right.
And when he tries to play this tape, he puts the helmet on his head, and it almost kills him.
Mm-hmm.
And he has to disable the machinery. And meanwhile, the military is watching all this because they're very invested mm-hmm. in this machine. And so he learns to play the tape, and you see that death is just this journey.
Mm-hmm.
And so again, I'm right back in the LSD world.
Sure.
And I thought it was so phenomenal and exciting and wonderful, but it didn't sell.
Yeah.
It just didn't sell.
Yeah.
So while we were in L.A. for the premiere, for which, by the way, we had no money to fly to L.A. for the premiere. I had to borrow it from the producer, and he didn't have any money. So we all arrive at the theater in one limousine. It was like the clowns coming out of the cars at the circus, one person after another, because we were all impoverished. And we saw the movie. And while we were there, we had lunch with Brian De Palma. And he said, Bruce, if you really want a career in Hollywood, you've got to move here. And Blanche, my wife, was sitting there, and she went back to DeKalb, quit her job, put her house on the market, and said, we're moving to Los Angeles. Hmm. the most courageous act ever, and I was traumatized. Because I, you know, what happens if you get there and nothing happens?
Right, right.
You know, I mean, Josh's story is so wonderful because something happened. Yeah. But I thought I may not be as lucky as that.
Yeah.
And so I was really terrified.
Well, and you can always use that in any fight you guys have.
Yes.
Moving forward, it's always like, I moved here from DeKalb for you. Remember that.
Believe
you're like,
me,
all right,
believe
yeah,
me,
you're right.
We've been together 46 years because she had the courage to give me everything, really. And we've had an extraordinary life because of her courage. And so we came out to Hollywood, and then it was like magic. When you find the right soil, mm-hmm. you know, the seed takes root.
Okay, so Jacob's Ladder. Then were there attempts at getting it made with other people attached to it originally?
Well, it was shown around, and I was telling someone today. At one point, Ridley Scott was very interested in doing it, and I was on my way back from Chicago for some reason, and I was driving toward DeKalb. I don't know if you guys know DeKalb, but I drove 1 hour past it. I was so caught up in the idea that Ridley was going to make my movie that I just thought, oh, my God, and I was driving and driving. But he didn't make mm-hmm. the movie, and Adrian Lyne did. And you know, Adrian's a wonderful director, and I think mm-hmm. what he made was quite remarkable.
Mm-hmm. You were telling me last night you watched it again, and it's been a long time since you've seen it. And there were some things that you would do differently.
Right. I just saw it last week. The Writers Guild did a 25-year sort of screening of Ghost and then Jacob's Ladder, double bill, which is powerful because I hadn't seen them on big screens in almost that length of time. Mm-hmm. And Ghost held up wonderfully. Mm-hmm. I mean, almost better than I could have imagined it. And Jacob's Ladder, I started to feel I could fix that. There are changes I could make, plus the fact that Adrian never shot the last part of the movie. So he found another way out of it because he wouldn't do special effects. Adrian was always about what I can do in camera, which was wonderful. Mm-hmm. But I had a big Spielbergian ending that he did not shoot. So I was always worried about whether this film was going to have an ending at all. Mm-hmm. The fact that it does, the fact that it comes together and has the integrity that it has is very, very important to me. Mm-hmm. And so I watched it. And it's funny, as I was watching it, I couldn't remember how it ended. I'm going, what happened there? Why? It was really strange. And then I saw, oh, yeah, we cut that whole section out right at the very end, and we did all this. And then I watched the film going, this still is very, it's a very potent experience.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I showed it to my kids, and they loved it. I mean, they loved it. And it's not really a kid film, really, at all, you know?
It was what I think. I thought it would be like The Sixth Sense, which kind of takes mm-hmm. a lot from it, actually.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
I thought it would be that in the theaters, but it really wasn't because audiences didn't get it. And also, the studio didn't know how to market it. They mm-hmm. weren't sure what they had, really.
Yeah, you can tell. The Blu-ray of it is like, uh-huh. I mean, the cover is ridiculous. Huh. I mean, it's just like this horror film. Ah! Jacob's Ladder, and it's not like that at
right.
all.
No, it's not. It's know? Not. But that's what they thought they had.
Yeah, yeah.
And there was nothing I could do to really persuade them it was different than that.
But if I do sort of compare it to Sixth Sense, I mean, there's a feeling of in Jacob's Ladder of dread in it. There's so much fear in it until he lets go of that fear.
Right.
And I know what you're saying by that. And you know that could have. You know, maybe audiences were a little bit freaked out by that. That scene when he has that fever in the bathtub and they're pouring ice on him, I mean, that is so visceral.
That was me. I was 8 years old.
Really?
It came directly from my life. I had a fever of 108 and the doctor said, you're not going to make it to the hospital.
So you got dumped in a bathtub with ice?
With ice. Ooh. For 8 hours.
Wow.
Oh. To bring my fever down. Oh. So it filtered right into the movie. It was a perfect
film.
Oh, wow.
Well, it's really real.
No, it's that film is kind of scary in the way that you don't want to be scared. It kind of goes a little too deep and a little touches a few too many nerves, but I think they're worth touching.
Sure.
And so I wrote it for that, and I think it did what it wanted to do. I imagined it probably would have faded away by now, but what I've discovered, strangely, I don't know about this university, but so many college sophomores, or people tell me they watched Jacob's Ladder as college sophomores when they were stoned. it was like a rite of passage, just like Knock Knock Jokes in the second grade.
Sure.
I don't know if you know this, Knock Knock Jokes are still in the second grade. They still tell them just like they just learned them for the first time. But Jacob's Ladder would hit people in their sophomore year in college, and it would kind of register.
Yeah, that subway scene. Mm. That's when you're stoned and you're like, whoa, oh, you see the faces.
Right. Right. Yeah. Was that really there?
Yeah. Let's talk a little bit about theme then. So this, I mean, clearly, you know, I just take those two films and I can see the themes that you're exploring there. How do you go about coming up with these themes? How do you translate them to film? I mean, I know that a lot of different writers work different ways. Do you start with theme first, or do you kind of let theme overtake you and then?
Well, I do. I mean, it's probably not the way to start writing a movie. I don't think most people should do that necessarily, unless you have strong themes in your life. I think, you know, it's great to go from character. It's great to enter a story without knowing where it's going, to find yourself in this process of writing rather than to dictate in the direction of it. You know, it's something about the exploration of writing that's so phenomenal in terms of what it gives you as a person. And I kind of got there. I just knew the themes I want to talk about is basically life is not what it appears to be, that there's something much bigger going on, that this idea of the infinite and eternal, perhaps future of life beyond here, is not. I want to write about the eternal and the infinite here, and I also want to write about life, sort of within a framework that includes something before life and something after life. Mm-hmm. In other words, it's a part of a larger continuum. I really wanted to touch those themes, and in a sense, that's what I was told to do. Mm-hmm. So I just said, okay, I've been trying to find ways to do it, and I kept working on different story ideas, and some would come together, and some would not, but. You know, you keep at it, and then you start to find your voice with those themes. But again, it took me a long time, so my career started fairly late. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I do think it's important to know what your voice is. Mm-hmm. What do you need to talk to the world about? And I try to tell people, you got 2 hours to talk to the world. What do you want to say? Mm-hmm. And if all you want to do is scare people, which is understandable, you can do it. It's the easiest thing to do, to write horror film, but if that's all you want to do, okay, do it. But if you can invest it with some sense of who you are and what you're about and why it scares you and where does fear come from and what is fear about, how does it resolve itself? Does it resolve itself? You know, what's going on here? I think all that's really important. And unless you know who you are in the writing process, you're just going to replicate everything people have done before you, and that's really problematic. I didn't want to replicate. Plus, I had stuff to talk about that I hadn't seen anybody else talking about. So I had to find my own language for it, my own sort of dramatic structure that would contain these things, and that's hard.
Right.
It was really hard.
Well, I find that we were talking a little bit ago about how the themes that you explore are so, I mean, universal that I'm surprised that there's not a, you know, people banging down your door to get more of the. I mean, you look at Ghost, and I mean that is a very successful film. Not because Patrick Swayze is in it or Demi Moore is in it. It's because
that didn't hurt.
It didn't hurt, right? Of course, right? I mean, that, you know, a lot of times the film's not going to get made without that.
Right.
But what it's saying is gives people hope that maybe this isn't everything that's there. You know?
It's a rather simple construct. It just basically says the end is not the end. That's all it says, really. But it says it with a kind of, I don't know if authority is the right word, but it's not a fantasy. They're just saying this is not how it ends. And it impacts people. And I tell people this story because I heard it not that long ago. When the plane landed in the East River in New York, and all these people were escaping onto the wings of the plane, one guy told the New York Times, he said, all I could think about was Patrick Swayze and Ghost. And I think my body's on the plane and I'm standing on the wing. And it was like, all I could think of was, oh my God, this movie, a guy thought he was dying and he's thinking of my movie.
Right, right.
That's a very strange thing that it had come somehow really gotten into the psyche.
Yeah.
And that I like about it because it gives you a kind of instruction. It also tells you that shadows might be demons or something waiting to pull you away. You know, it kind of gives you a different way of looking at the world you're in. Right. The idea that there may be people around looking at us. I mean, I don't know if any of that's true. Mm-hmm. But the idea of that makes you think differently. It makes you have a different kind of tangential approach to what life is as you've understood it before.
But there's also something, I mean, again, I don't want to get too touchy-feely, but it's something like comforting about, you know, I saw Armageddon, and then I saw Deep Impact, and they couldn't be two more, I mean, opposite films, yet it's the same story pretty much. And Deep Impact, there was something about it that, you know, I didn't leave the theater humming the theme song to it or anything, but it made me think and feel, whereas Armageddon didn't.
Well, I actually liked Armageddon, but I have a really good feeling about Deep Impact. Except, you know, I started writing it. My son said, "Dad, you're not satisfied with just killing off two people. You have to kill off the human race. You know,
what's
wrong with you?" But that meteor story was very powerful. It was Spielberg's idea. I mean, we talked about doing a remake of When Worlds Collide, which was a very important film when I was a kid. And then the more I researched it, I realized, you know, this whole thing with the dinosaurs and the comets colliding with the Earth and all of that. And we just turned it into a different movie. And so I did all the science on it, and the science is very real. I mean, unbelievably so. And it was great. The research on that film was more fun than I've ever had. You know, because if you knew Steven's name, you have access to everything and everyone in the world. Sure. So you sit in the White House, you're with all the NASA scientists. You know, you just go everywhere. But that film, in the end, for me, was about the fragility of our existence. You know, that we really. There's no given here, you know. I mean, you look at Nepal from last week, you know, I lived in Nepal, and I lived on Kathmandu, and you walk down those streets, and they're ancient, beautiful temples, and then suddenly, they're not there anymore. Yeah. Well, we're truly as fragile as that, but nothing in our psyche can buy into that, because we can't live like that.
Yeah.
On the other hand, you can live like that, and then, life becomes unbearably poignant. Mm-hmm. Because you always know there's no given here. Mm-hmm. You know, you can pretend there's a given. You can pretend it's really important that you buy that new dress or you buy that car or whatever. But the truth is you don't know moment to moment what's coming. Right. And I think there's a kind of undercurrent in Deep Impact that kind of gets at that.
Yeah,
for sure. And a certain real preciousness. And there's one moment in that film which I just love, which is when one of the guys on the rocket ship who can no longer see... And they're about to explode. They're about to detonate themselves to get rid of this comet that's coming toward us. And his wife comes rushing to the hospital,
control room.
Thank you. To show him the son that he's never met, and he can't see, but he can hear him.
Yeah.
So you have this end of the earth moment, completely focused into a woman and her child and her husband having a moment that is. The most remarkable, sweet, joyous thing that will ever happen to this man within instances of his demise.
Right, right.
And that's that kind of feeling to me is so powerful.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I look at life. I mean, I walk around amazed every day, to be honest, but I keep looking at, I don't know how the universe happened. I have no idea, but I know it didn't start out with anything other than dense matter and dense rock and fire and iron and all of this stuff, and somehow out of that came my granddaughter.
Right, right. yeah. It's amazing to think that. I my mind goes to that opening to Melancholia. Have you seen that?
Oh yeah.
I mean that is to me.
Same, yeah, powerful.
Oh my God. I mean,
I'm one of the people who really like that film.
Yeah,
a lot of people don't, but of course you can tell.
I really liked it too. Right.
Speak to
I
me.
Thought it was good. You worked with Tolkien on. On Deep Impact, he did The Rapture also.
Yes, yeah, Michael Tolkien.
Did
not work together.
Okay, so
it's a long story.
A bad story?
Yeah.
Oh,
well, it's a Hollywood story.
It's a bad story.
Well, I worked on Deep Impact for a very long time, and Stephen called me one day from his car phone. I'm at home, and he says, "You know, I think I want to try a hand at this myself." I said, "What?" He said, "Yeah, I just want to see if what." And I said, "Stephen, does that mean I'm fired?" And he said, "Well, yeah, I guess it does." And I went, "Oh, okay, huh?" And I hung up the phone, and I was kind of, I didn't know what to do with it because he and I had really worked out beat by beat where that film was going to go. So I had written the film that we had talked about.
Right.
And then I get a call from the heads of the company saying, "Stephen would like you to come back and continue on the film." And I said, "No."
Damn it.
And I didn't say damn it. I just said no. I, You know, like you get to a point, honestly, in Hollywood, where you just don't want to be run around so much anymore. Sure. And I didn't need to be. Mm-hmm. I just didn't need it. So yeah. I just said no. And they hired Michael. And then, I'll be honest, Michael's draft was way off. Mm-hmm. And they brought in John Wells, who the showrunner for West Wing. And he just pulled it back. Mm-hmm. And he pulled it back very close to what I had done. Mm-hmm. So I was very grateful, obviously. Okay. And so, but Michael and I knew each other. We used to have writers meetings in LA. Don't ever go to a writers meeting where all the top writers in Hollywood were together. And not one of us had a happy story to tell about Hollywood. So we would all sit around telling our sob stories. And finally we said, why are we getting together anymore? So we just stopped as a group. But we had such horrible stories. And so Michael and I knew each other from that group. And I like Michael very much. I think he's a terrific writer. But I have to say, we had to share credit on that film. It was mm-hmm. to be arbitrated. And I just said, well, can I take first position since I wrote the first draft and you take second? Because mm-hmm. it was other. And he said, sure. Mm-hmm. So it was fine. You know, I'm not really interested in ownership mm-hmm. in Hollywood. You know, I care about what gets out there. Mm-hmm. And I really was grateful that when I saw Deep Impact for the first time at a screening, when it was finished, I just went, it works. Yeah. It works. Yeah. It will speak to people.
Yeah.
It will have impact, literally. Mm. And that's all I wanted. And I don't care who gets the credit, whether it's me or somebody else. I mean, you know, the idea is to get it out there.
Right.
You know, I wasn't told, you know, tell people what you saw with your name on it. Mm-hmm. Just present as much as you can, put it in the atmosphere and see where it goes.
Right. So do you have any, you know, we have a lot of folks here that are getting into this for a lot of different reasons, right? Some of them are getting into it because, you know, they want to make $1 million and be the most powerful moguls in the industry. Some people are doing it because, as I would tell like my parents, I can't do anything else, right? And so, and then others are doing it because they really love it. And can you give
sure, I think you
piece
just,
of advice?
I think
maybe?
You just said it. I think loving it is really important. I had two skills. One was typing and the other was writing. Mm-hmm. And typing did not pay well. I tried to use that as much as I could. You know, I would work as a secretary.
So you have to look at your fingers.
Yeah, exactly.
Wow.
So that was a very big skill. It was the only skill I've ever had, by the way, is to typing. And so I tried, you know, to figure out what else I could do, and I couldn't do anything else. So I had to write, and I wanted to write, and I wanted to write movies. And I love, like you and like everybody here, I think. I love movies. I just love, I mean, how can you not? Mm-hmm. And so I had to do movies, and I really believe that you have to find out why you particularly need to tell a story. Mm-hmm. And what is your story? What do you know? And it usually starts really close to home, and most people don't look there. Mm-hmm. They're always looking somewhere else. And as, like I said earlier, often at other movies. Mm-hmm. So a lot of films are replicants of other films, and they do not satisfy. Mm-hmm. They don't breathe. They don't have life. You know, they're just, they move quickly, and they keep you for 2 hours kind of glued to the screen. Mm-hmm. But you walk out of the theater depleted. You don't walk out nurtured. You don't walk out full. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you feel like you had an appetizer when you wanted a meal.
Right.
You know, it's very frustrating. The
right,
whole
well, we're also so afraid to think we have something valid to say. You know?
Your life is valid. I mean, that's the most important. Your own life is valid. Why is your life your own life? What is it that distinguishes it? And so many people don't feel good about themselves, or they don't understand their own journey. That's kind of like everybody. Mm-hmm. None of us know who we are, really, or what our journey is, and we're all struggling to figure that out. We'll struggle in public, mm-hmm. because everyone will identify with that. Right. Show the unfolding that's coming out of you as you try to figure out what's going on. If you're having a bad love affair, you know, all the great songwriters, that they write about all those things.
Right. Yeah.
We should too.
Right.
You know, and you just have to give it three-act structure, you know. but you have to do that.
Right.
And you have to find out. I mean, it's so simple. Films are so simple. You've got what are you rooting for?
Mm-hmm.
What's obstructing it? You know?
Mm-hmm.
The key things. You want to root for something that's you can't let go of. And you've got to have so many obstructions that you can't bear it, and then you have to deliver.
Mm-hmm.
something that people want in the end. And it's not always what you think. And I use Casablanca always as an example, because I think it's the most kind of spiritual film ever made, although nobody would identify it that way. But in Casablanca, you are rooting for Humphrey Bogart to get Ingrid Bergman, right, because that's what you think you want. Mm-hmm. But it's not, mm-hmm, because he lets go of Ingrid Bergman for the sake of something bigger. And whatever that is, that ennobles him so much that you feel he found something bigger than love. He found himself. Mm-hmm. And I don't know why it satisfies so much, mm-hmm, but it does. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what we're all looking for, something that is selfless, courageous, willing to give up oneself for something bigger. Mm-hmm. And I love that. Also, a lot of people approach me about how do I write a spiritual movie? And I have to point them to Casablanca, because mm-hmm, you can't write about transcendence. Mm-hmm. You just can't. Nobody's rooting for it in the world. You're rooting for love, courage, self-sacrifice, all of these qualities that make you bigger than you were. Mm-hmm. And that's what we're trying to find our road to that. Yeah. And great love stories really are just that. Great love stories, even when you get the girl in the end, you got to let go of something to get the girl. You can't become part of a couple without sacrificing something. Sure. Sure. So it's a great journey for all of us.
It's great. I was speaking earlier about how the older I get, the more I realize that I don't know as much as I thought I knew, and it's actually exciting.
Well, as I said to you earlier, I've only learned that. I have learned that I really don't know anything, mm-hmm, and it's been a profound awareness for me. I mean, bigger than anything I've ever known. Everything I thought I knew. It was in a contained space, mm-hmm, you know, and in the world you can know a lot, but the minute you break that apart, you see how minuscule your knowledge is, mm-hmm, how unreal it is in some ways, and that you begin to go into what the Zen teachers called beginner's mind, mm-hmm, and beginner's mind is honestly where we all are, but nobody buys it. Mm-hmm. Everybody says, well, I got my PhD, and I have this, right, and I have that, and you know, you win your Oscar or whatever, and people think you know something. Mm-hmm. Trust me, if you live in this contained space, yes, you do, mm-hmm, but the minute you realize you don't exist only in that space, once you go deep into your psyche, you expand into this vastness of being, mm-hmm, that is so much bigger than you. You become so minuscule in it, but not lost in it, mm-hmm, but you just become one with something enormous. And that enormity is what we are, all of us collectively. Mm-hmm. And to touch that and to know that you don't, there's no way to understand it. There is no way. It is the mystery of mysteries. There was this great movie that came out this last Christmas called Leviathan.
Mm-hmm.
The Russian film.
With the GoPros they used on that, right, didn't they?
Oh, I don't even know about that.
It's sort of a documentary.
No, this is a feature film.
Oh,
it's a Russian film for Best Picture, Russian Best Foreign Film. But they talk about the unknowable unknown. It's called Leviathan. Mm-hmm. That's in the Bible. Leviathan is the unknowable unknown. Mm-hmm. Well, most of us don't grasp for a second that we don't know. Mm-hmm. And when you suddenly don't know, and you understand that we're all involved in something that may be eternal and infinite and unknowable, and it's not an abstract, and it's not Sunday school, and it's not something that you'll figure out when you leave this world. You're there now. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's no one who's not there now, but the fact that we don't know that is the source of probably all human suffering, mm-hmm, because we think we know, and we hold on to our knowledge, and we fight to be right, and trust me, you got to be wrong. You got to figure out that you're wrong. I don't care what you believe.
Do you ever find yourself writing not knowing what's going to be written?
Absolutely.
You know, like what they're going to say?
But that's true creation. Mm-hmm. Having something come out of nothing, out of nowhere, the spark of that is to feel godlike. Mm-hmm. You know, you're writing, where did that come from? Mm-hmm. It's like a great idea, a great line, a great scene, a great something. It just mm-hmm, arose. Right. Well, I have a feeling that's what we do. We just arise. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, I don't understand it. I used to think, again, that I did. Mm-hmm. Now I'm just like, right, how's this happening?
Right.
You know, and here it is, here we are.
Right.
And
right,
why is it happening? I don't know.
Yeah. I know I'm going over, I see that. So I'd like to open it up for some questions. And while we get them going here, there we go. Okay.
My apologies, by the way, if this was not the movie talk you wanted to hear.
We're all gonna go drop acid after this, right? Or LSD.
And I'm really not trying to push that. I'm really trying to push. Do whatever you can to find who you are.
To go inward.
To go inward
instead of outward.
It doesn't have to be drug
induced. Joseph Campbell has this great. He was talking about how just going to. He liked to go to cathedrals and churches and stuff, not because he's a praying man or anything like that, but because they force you, when you walk in there, they force you to go into, like, this you.
That's the
and
idea.
And it's so different.
Yeah.
And then you're walking around outside the city of Chicago, the L train and the draft over here and all this stuff.
It's a moment out of time. Yeah. I step into churches and synagogues and mosques and temples all the time just to bring it back.
It's pretty amazing. Okay.
Hi. My favorite movie that you've done is My Life. I was wondering if you could talk about what inspired that and just the process of directing that film and et cetera.
You know, after Ghost, I could do anything I wanted, kind of, which is an amazing, terrifying thing. I mean, they were willing to let me direct. They were willing to, you know, it was really, everybody was just so generous at that point. But, you know, Ghost was made for the equivalent of today's dollars, about $40 million. It was really more like 20. And it made almost $1 billion. So, you know, in today's dollars. So they wanted that again, you know. And so I had to come up with something that would show them I could do that. And I had all these sort of ideas, but it's very scary. Winning an Oscar is very scary because you have expectations now that are so enormous that you don't know where anything came from. How do you know you can do it again? You really don't. So I kept thinking of what could I do? And I went to bed and I ate some, I don't know, pizza or a Mexican dinner, and I had such an upset stomach and I thought I was dying. And I said, oh my God, I'm dying. And I had a little kid at home, he was a little boy. And I said, oh, he's never gonna know me. He'll never know who I am. And I thought, well, what can I do? I can make a video about me that I could leave for him. And the minute I said that, there's a movie. Just slammed out of my head. And then I thought, well, it's not a movie if I just make a video about if I know who I am. It's a video, it's a movie if I don't know who I am and I try to make that video. That became really compelling. So I had to write a movie about a guy, an advertising guy who thinks he knows who he is and what his life is about. He can't get anybody to talk on tape about him because nobody likes him. He's totally self-absorbed and unexamined. And it's a journey of that examination. And he discovers he's dying. And he doesn't know what he's going to be able to leave his son in. So he's becoming, over the course of a movie, a human being. Mm-hmm. And then the movie wasn't working for the longest time. Everybody read the script, they loved it, but it wasn't working. And we couldn't figure out why it wasn't working. And I remember Blanche and I went to Africa with the kids. We took this amazing trip. And Africa is a great, by the way, if you want to learn about yourself, go to Africa and go on safari, because you're just part of the food chain, and it's really an astounding thing for you to realize. And a lot of things happen there. And it was while I was there, I just started to have this idea for a new character. And I came back to America, and this character of Mr. Ho, which is a healer, comes into the picture. And Mr. Ho makes you think your character is going to survive. He's going to be healed by this magical mystery guy. And the fact is, he is healed by him, but he doesn't live. Mm-hmm. But the fact that he's healed became the clarity that was needed for that story. And the minute I presented that script to the studio and everyone else, they said, yes, this was it. And that's when we knew we had a movie.
Mm. It's like the Casablanca. It's like the bigger, what's more important isn't really living, it is...
He dies whole.
Yeah.
That's what it's about.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, Bruce. Thank you for sharing everything that you've shared with us tonight. You know, what I'm getting from your, from you speaking to us is really, you know, your authenticity is key to breaking out in any industry or any kind of, whatever you want to convey to the world. So I don't really have a question. I just really wanted to thank you for, because I get what you're saying. And
I can tell you get it, and you just said it perfectly.
Thank you.
Really, thank you.
I have sort of a weird question. I went into Birdman not knowing anything about it, and as soon as the credits rolled, the first thing I thought of was like, boy, this is just like Jacob's Ladder, except that instead of dying in Vietnam, as I interpreted Jacob's Ladder, he actually died when in that when he was in the ocean and caught in those jellyfish or something. Now, no one else I've talked to agrees with this interpretation, and so I just thought I'd bounce it off you and see if you thought the entire movie he was actually dead and he had actually died back in that anecdote he related to his wife where he was caught in the ocean in some jellyfish or something. And
no, I didn't have that at all. I mean, I don't discount that as a possibility. I took it pretty literally. You know, I mean, I love seeing Michael Keaton in that film because when he was in My Life, he was a very vain guy, and he would never go around bald. I shouldn't talk about this, but he had hair implants, and the hair implants meant that I couldn't shoot him from certain angles because you could see grid systems on his head, and it made it very hard to shoot. And suddenly, here was Michael, pretty much naked in the movie on every level, viscerally, personally, emotionally, and I was so thrilled for him in this film that's what I was watching the whole time. I'm saying, oh my God, this guy has truly grown as an actor and as a person, and I was really so happy about that. Mm-hmm. It was really wonderful. I don't know about your theory, but it's an interesting one. Yeah,
thank you. And he didn't have to die like in My Life.
No, right? He didn't have to die.
Hi. Thank you so much for everything. This is just the best. But I just had a question about, like, my favorite movie you've been in is Tales from the Script. And just because, like, watching that movie just gets me, like, fired up, right? But I just wanted to ask, like, what is your process? You talked about meditation. To me, that's, like, really important to my pre-writing. But, like, what's your daily process for writing, I guess, if you still write every day?
I'm not writing anymore, but when I was, I would get up every morning, and I would do rewriting in the morning of everything I wrote the day before. And in the afternoon, I would generate new material. And I would always have, I think, the standard contract gave me 10 weeks to write a script. I would always have a script written in 10 weeks. You can generate a lot of material in 3 pages a day, 4 pages a day. And I don't care where they come. If they come just before you go in the house for dinner, it doesn't matter, but they just have to come. And I would not go in the house for dinner if they hadn't come. So I had to produce those 4 pages every day, 5 days a week. And 2 days a week, I would be with my family and my kids, you know, and have a life, which I think is really, really important. Don't let writing take over your life. Have a life. You know, it's what we're here for. And writing will draw from that life. The more you expose yourself to the world, the more stuff will come into your writing and tell your own personal journeys. Jacob's Ladder, I had a chiropractor named Louis, and he became a real character in that movie. And every chiropractor in America loves me now so much because I made them into heroes.
Yeah, they're
angels,
right?
Yeah. And so, you know, draw from the immediacy of your life. It's really an extraordinary thing. And you know, and just write your heart out, and you'll find toward the end of a script, you kind of have to write. You'll probably start writing nights and weekends because it starts to build up a momentum, and you can't stop, and so you just keep surging ahead. When that happens, let it go. It's really wonderful. You'll be taken care of by the words.
I had a question. So, what was your opinion of the final product of Deadly Friend?
The what part?
Deadly Friend.
Deadly Friend.
What was my opinion of Deadly Friend?
Yes.
I loved making Deadly Friend. I love working with Wes Craven because he's terrific. It wasn't called Deadly Friend originally. It was Friend. It was based on a book that I didn't like very much. And I was going to turn the assignment down. And I was meditating. And this voice comes into my head, my teacher, who was a New York businessman guru type, and he said, "Schmuck." He said, I was feeling this that idea that I had was maintaining my integrity in not writing this movie. And he said, "There's more integrity in providing for your family than turning down jobs." He said, "Get up right now, go to the phone, call the producer at 7 a.m. and call him and tell him you figured out how to do it." Mm-hmm. And I did. And I got the job. And that job, I had no money very much. We had just moved to Hollywood, and that job kept us going. And then the really extraordinary part was, I mean, there's many extraordinary parts, because my kids became mascots on the set. It was shot at Warner Brothers. We would drive over every night and every afternoon that we could, and the kids would run around, and we had the best time. But then when the film was over, and I hadn't had another job yet, my son was having his bar mitzvah, and we didn't have any money, or not enough money. So I figured it was going to be the first peanut butter and jelly bar mitzvah in Los Angeles history. And we didn't know what to do. And all of a sudden, a residual check came in for Deadly Friend, my first real residual. And I was like, wow. And I look at it, I opened it up, and I see $3,900. And I'm going, oh my God, that's so great. And my wife says, no, look, there's another zero. It was like $39,000. And my son had a really wonderful bar mitzvah. So it was great.
Yeah, that's awesome.
I'd ask, who came up with the basketball scene in that movie?
You know what happened? We were screening the film. We made a really good film. And we were screening it for the Warner Brothers executives. And Mark Canton was the president. And the film wasn't playing very well. The audiences weren't engaged enough. And when the film was over, Mark turned to Wes and to me, and he said, you've got to make it bloodier. And he said, what we have to do is add 6 more scenes, and each has to be bloodier than the one before. So Wes was thrilled by that. And so we just brought in this really gruesome series of scenes, but the last one was the worst, where you take the basketball and you knock off her head, the robot knocks off her head. If you haven't seen this film, don't bother. But but it's really horrendously scary and disturbing. And then we showed it for a preview audience, and I've never seen anything like it. The kids got on their chairs, yes, yes! And they thought it was the greatest thing ever that we destroyed this woman and did all these horrible things. And then the ratings board came, and they started telling us what to cut out. And Wes said to me, every frame of this film that gets cut is another million lost at the box office. And we lost a lot at the box office. Mm. And so it didn't become a successful film at all. But it was a wonderful experience. I really loved it. And this idea of maintaining integrity in Hollywood is really important. Sometimes you've got to write the film you don't want to write. Sometimes you've got to do what you got to do because you got to pay the bills. Mm-hmm. And that's just the way it is. And be grateful that the universe presented something, anything, right, for you to do.
Right. This will be a last question.
Bruce, hi. Thanks for putting together Jacob's letter. That was cool. I've just realized I've had a relationship with a chiropractor for 29 years.
Wow.
And I've got a question and a comment. One question is, did you find that you write much better in out on the West Coast than you did here or somewhere else?
Not really. You know, I mean, you have to find what works for you. I don't know what happened with me, but I was watching. I used to work at a desk, and I would lean over, and I started getting this enormous headaches. Just the weight of my head hanging down. You know, they describe your head, the chiropractors do, as the weight of a bowling ball. And when you sit like this, you're pulling this your spine, and it really hurts. So I remember the opening scenes of Alien, and you know, that creature that's used. I don't know if you remember the creature at the beginning, when they go into that strange place, but he's sitting like this, you know, like and a reclining kind of chair. It's a very bizarre looking thing, but I said, that's how I want to write. and I've been writing in a reclining chair ever since, and I keep a pillow behind my neck so I don't strain it, and I am in another world. I'm just sitting here typing and typing and typing, and I feel like I'm an alien, but I love writing in that way. It's a very easy mode to work.
And then the comment is, you're the first person I think I've heard or met in about 30 years that commented on not knowing, as my African-American guru used to say, Marshall, you'll have to know that you know that you know that you know that you don't know and will never know, only to receive. It seems that you've hit on a tremendous state of primal process, and to me that with that LSD trip, which I had a couple of minor ones, and then I followed Buddy Rich for 51 years, who was a Hebrew from Brooklyn. It seems that you're in an Andromedian state, is what I'm getting out of your...
It's been a great journey.
Great journey.
That's all, okay, I can tell you.
There's a couple other of Andromedians here I met with Mr. JP and his wife. But
we're everywhere. Wait, I shouldn't reveal that.
Okay, but it astounds me that you hit on that. I have never heard that since he passed out.
It's not original to me.
Okay, thanks very much, Bruce.
Sure.
Thank you. Well, with that, I would like to thank you, Bruce. And thank you.